and of India. Just to put things in context, let's look at the Indian economy. During the period of the East India Company and during the period of British colonization, around 1700, the per capita incomes were close to each other. In fact, if you went back to 1600, the per capita income in India was probably higher than that of the United Kingdom. But during that period of 1850 onwards, you see a huge upturn in the economy of the United Kingdom, whereas the economy of India has remained fairly flat. And I think this is very important to address from a number of perspectives. As far as health is concerned, the health of the Indian population in 1950 was probably very similar to the health of the Indian population in 1700, because the economy, and so too were the cultures, the type of jobs, it was much more agricultural, etc. Whereas the UK population had started industrializing. So to make a comparison in 1950 between the health of UK versus the health of India, we will have to address this 150-year period where the economy is separated so rapidly. And I think what is important is that period of Western European colonization, only a handful of countries benefited from it. Other than 10 countries, the rest of the world was shut off. So much of the differences you see, whether in economics, whether in health, whether in cultures, whether in ways of life, whether in governance, etc., I think that period explains quite a bit. But I do believe that we are entering an era where that gap can be narrowed very substantially and very rapidly. And the other thing that I want to point out to you is look at those numbers. In 1750, the ratio of the population of India to UK was 5.2. Whereas by 1950, that ratio had moved to 14 to 100, which means that in absolute terms and in relative terms, the population of the United Kingdom increased, suggesting that rapid economic growth and a growth in population are not necessarily incompatible. What it really means is that you need a population that is educated and is productive, and you're talking about quality of life. So I think when people argue that India is poor because of a large population, I think that question, there's part truth to it, but there's also part untruth to it. I think that needs to be re-examined. Look at post-independence India. The Indian economy was almost flat from 1950 till about the late 1980s. And then you start seeing an exponential increase in India's GDP, which I think, and when such a rapid change happens, it introduces very dynamic changes in society. It changes society in all kinds of ways, some good, some not so good. And the art of good governance is managing the process in a manner that you maximize the good and you minimize the bad. And I think that is where the collective effort of so many people becomes so important. But in terms of future projections, and these are projections from the IMF, there have been projections from the World Bank, from so many other organizations, all pointing out that the growth of the economies of low and middle income countries, India included, China included, is faster, more rapid, and over the next 20, 30, 40 years, you're going to see the developing countries in the world emerging as fairly solid economic powers. As you see there, by 2030, China, US, India, Brazil end up becoming the leading economies of the world in terms of GDP. Doesn't mean there won't be poverty in this country, doesn't mean per capita income will be uniformly spread, but it does mean that the economies of these countries are improving. And just to give you, put this to you in context, suppose an economy is growing at 1% per annum, which is what Western Europe has been doing on average for some time. It takes that economy 72 years to double. Whereas an economy growing at 6 to 7% per annum, in that 72 years, would probably grow 100-fold. So that is why we have to stretch our imagination from our cross-sectional comparisons of today to a different picture of tomorrow and position ourselves in a way so catch-up can happen. But you've got to position, you've got to be both hopeful about the catch-up and position the catch-up in a manner that you're able to spread the positive benefits to the largest segment of the population. I think that is going to be the challenge. And look, already, when you look at the GDP of India, the contributors to the GDP, it's already beginning to change. Agriculture as a percentage of GDP is declining, whereas the percentage of GDP coming from service industry is going. The other industries, the manufacturing industries, have not shifted that much but are remaining steady. But this also introduces major changes in lifestyle. Because the lifestyle, the diet, the physical activity you would have, the kind of cultures that you would have in a traditional agricultural society would be very different from a culture that you would have from a more urbanized, service-driven society. And that affects health in ways that you would not imagine. And that's where I will take you to in the next few minutes. The second very important determinant of destiny and of health is demography. We don't pay enough attention to demography, but let's look at the world demography overall. Interestingly, the world as a whole achieved its first billion population around 1800. So for millions of years, we had lived in a fairly underpopulated world as a human species. But for better or for worse, as a human species, we invented ways to prolong our lives and to increase our tribe, if you like. And now there has been this exponential growth. And the Indian subcontinent, which had already been a fairly densely populated area for a variety of reasons, for history in terms of the length of history, the fertility of the area, in terms of food production, etc., has experienced a fairly large increase and also a fairly large population mass. But let's try to understand what factors may have contributed overall in terms of global picture for the rise in the populations and for the improvements in health status, say, during the 19th century. Let's use the United Kingdom as an example. And the classic work in this area was done by Thomas McEwen, who analyzed death rates in the United Kingdom over a 100-year period from somewhere 1830 to 1920 or 1930, and documented massive declines in death rates in the United Kingdom. So people in the United Kingdom started living longer, and it boiled down, really, to declines in six major infectious diseases that were killing people. And I'm showing you here just four of them: tuberculosis, streptococcal infection, Clostridium, diphtheria, and smallpox. But what is striking from these graphs is for several of these diseases, the decline in terms of mortality from those diseases had started long before medical innovations, had started long before vaccination, long before antibiotics, and in cases even long before the bacilli were identified. So something other than medical progress and technological progress in terms of direct medical application had happened. So the conclusion, McEwen's conclusion, and it's quite non-controversial, was that the population growth of the United Kingdom and improvement in their health in terms of reductions in mortality, reductions in communicable diseases in the period 1770 to 1900, were largely due to improvements in environmental factors and to nutrition. And in fact, his analysis demonstrated that almost 90% of the improvement was because of better access to nutrition. The population was better fed, and secondly, improvements of hygiene and sanitation played a huge role. And the contribution, you might be surprised, as physicians that I was, that I trained as a physician myself, the contribution of medicine in terms of antibiotics and vaccination played a very small but important role towards the end. So that's one thing that I would like you to take in your mind, is that when you're talking of health of a population, there are things outside of medicine that are far, far more powerful than what medicine can deliver. And those things are really things at the societal, political, sociological, and environmental levels. The result of some of these major improvements is now being felt across the world. I mean, across the world, people are living longer. And in fact, one of the greatest successes of the past 20, 25 years has been massive reductions in childhood mortality, massive reductions in maternal mortality. And yes, India still has high levels of childhood mortality and maternal mortality, but India is also experiencing huge improvements in those areas. And as you can see there, almost every country of the world is experiencing longer life expectancies, and it's only projected to improve further. In the US, some over 35 years of life expectancy was gained within 100 years. But in a country like in China and India, that kind of gain in life expectancy is happening in half the time, which means that the problem of a larger population has to be dealt with half the time. And in terms of the health issues, even the least developed economies, like for example, sub-Saharan Africa, where life expectancies were shortened because of the HIV epidemic, even that is beginning to change thanks to global effort to treat HIV infections worldwide. So we are beginning to face a world with longer life expectancy, more aging populations everywhere, and there are very few exceptions to this. The result of this is really a change in the health, in the pattern of health. There was a time when you could very clearly differentiate the health of high-income countries from the health patterns of low-income countries. But that is becoming less and less clear, and in fact, it's going to become even less clear in the future. These are data, I'm sorry for this rather crowded table before you. These are data from a famous project called the Global Burden of Disease. And I'd like to take you through these graphs. On the left side is in the year 1990, only 25 years ago. And shown in blue are the causes of death due to non-communicable diseases or non-infectious diseases. But shown in pink are causes of death either due to infections or diseases of poverty, undernutrition, etc. What you're seeing in terms of the transition, in terms of the 25 leading causes of death, is between the period 1990 and 2010, there has been a major shift in the pattern in terms of the leading causes of death. While in 1990, there were many of the pink bars, that is beginning to change by year 2010. So by now in 2010, the leading causes of death worldwide are ischemic heart disease, stroke, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, and as you see there, even diabetes has moved from number 15 to about number 7 or number 9. So clearly you're seeing a shift now from diseases of childhood, diseases of infection, more towards diseases of adulthood or young adulthood, and diseases of non-communicable nature. This is something very important to remember. And again, when you look in terms of the leading risk factors for death rates worldwide, the top 10 risk factors worldwide, when you look at that list, these are high blood pressure, tobacco use, high blood glucose, physical inactivity, overweight and obesity, high cholesterol levels, unsafe sex, alcohol use or alcohol misuse, childhood underweight, and indoor air pollution. That's worldwide. And those same 10 risk factors are common across high-income, middle-income, and low-income countries, although the order varies. And the other thing that I'd like to point out to you is of those 10 risk factors, almost 7 are related to cardiometabolic diseases, diseases like heart disease, obesity, diabetes. And in contexts like India, even underweight at childhood, in terms of at birth, is a risk factor for later chronic diseases. And I will show you some data towards the end of my talk. When you look at it another way, because chronic diseases are not just about killing people early, they allow people to live long with disability. So we need to look at the impact in terms of disability-adjusted life years. And when you do that, and you map the leading risk factors for disability-adjusted life years, we call it DALYs. Look at that list there. The leading causes today are high blood pressure, tobacco smoking, alcohol misuse, indoor air pollution, diets low in fruits. We were having this conversation yesterday. Fruit deficiency is a major cause of chronic disease worldwide. High body mass index or obesity, high fasting glucose, childhood underweight, physical inactivity, and diets high in sodium, and diets low in nuts and fruits and vegetables, etc. So dietary factors, pollution, tobacco use, high blood pressure, physical inactivity are becoming increasingly very important to address as we move forward and address the health of large populations. This is an extremely important slide. Data produced by the World Economic Forum. We talk a lot about the importance of economic development, about GDP growth. And I think the Indian Prime Ministers have been correct in terms of emphasizing economic growth. But I'd like to point out to you that health and economic growth are not mutually exclusive. Health is required for good economic growth, and good economic growth is required for good health. I do not think you can ever afford. And look at the graph there. This graph shows you major factors, and on the x-axis, it shows you the likelihood of those factors happening. And on the y-axis, it's showing you about the severity of the impact of those factors, if they happened, on economic development. I want to point out to you number five, which is the fiscal crisis, which we all went through a few years ago. The likelihood of its happening was high, its severity on the global economic development was high, there was big worldwide slowdown in terms of economy. But now look at number 31. It's chronic diseases, diseases like cardiovascular diseases, cancers, diabetes, lung diseases. The likelihood of that happening is very high, and it's already happening. And the impact of that happening on global economy is horrendously high. In fact, the risk as a risk factor is more important than your fiscal crisis. And I think this is something that your finance minister, Mr. Jaitley, needs to hear. Because I think it's also something that your health minister needs to hear. On the other hand, look at infectious diseases number 30. It would also have a huge impact on the economy. And why do you think the world paid attention to Ebola and H1N1? Yes, we were all worried about the impact on humanity and on health, but there was also a huge impact on potential impact on the economy. So I think connecting health to economic development is very, very important. It's not about one or the other, it's both. Ultimately, you want a good economy because you want people to live healthy and have a good lifestyle, and you want a peaceful community. So, and it's vice versa. So I'd like to point out to you the interconnectedness here of health and economic development. So while you focus, while the ministers talk about GDP growth rate, also ask them about some measure of health and disease improvement. I think that is very important. The question that is often posed is, are the health factors like diabetes and cardiovascular disease, is it genes or is it environment? And the true answer is, it's difficult to answer, it's both. But I think there's a useful quote from the father of modern diabetes, Elliot Joslin, after whom the Boston Diabetes Center is named, Joslin Diabetes Center. And he had this to say about diabetes some 80 years ago. He said the genes may load the cannon, but it is always the environment that pulls the trigger. And I'm going to show you some stories from studies from the Pima Indians that illustrates this point better than anything else can. That's how our human society has been evolving. I will let you all decide where you are in that evolution. But essentially, we have originated from monkeys, we've inhabited certain other places, and we are moving towards a society. We were meant to be physically active. We were meant to live in small groups supporting each other. We were meant to eat a lot of fruits and vegetables. We were meant to eat a lot of nuts. We were meant to play around and relax. We were meant to sleep when it's dark and stay awake when it's light. But we are changing our habits, and that is beginning to affect our health. So the question is, how do you adapt? So I'm going to use, in the next 5 or 6 minutes, some examples from type 2 diabetes, the disease that I've been studying for the past over 20 years. And I'd like to point out to you that type 2 diabetes is really a very ancient disease. It is not a new disease. But we are paying greater attention to it today because it is now facing a modern lifestyle and a modern environment. And just to put that things in history in context, because after all, against the backdrop of Nalanda, one is always reminded of the importance of history. History defines a lot of things. It tells us where we have come from. It may not tell us where we need to go. We have the power to alter that. Diabetes has been described by the Romans, the Greeks, the Arabs, the Indians. And I found this wonderful quote from Chandaka Samhita, written in the 6th century. He talks of diabetes. There are two forms of diabetes or madhumeha, honey neuron. One associated with emaciation, dehydration, polyuria, and lassitude, and the other with stout build, gluttony, obesity, and sleepiness. So remarkably similar to our current classification of diabetes as type 1 and type 2. Remarkable empirical observation. I think what has changed in these 1500 years is our ability to use technology to understand the disease process better and perhaps come up with better ways of both preventing and treating it. In terms of a PhD student of mine who was from anthropology, worked on a project trying to connect Indian history to the history of diabetes. And she found in her exploration that there were 25 words in the language of Sanskrit that were associated in one way or another with diabetes. So diabetes in the Indian context is not a new disease. I mean, it should clearly, there were 25 words in Sanskrit to talk about diabetes. It existed, but it existed in a rare form affecting a small group of people, and that might reflect the gross maldistribution of wealth and health in ancient times. It's very possible if one were to speculate backwards. But our modern understanding of diabetes, we owe a lot to this population, the Pima Indians of Arizona. And I had the pleasure and opportunity of working with this group, which there's a study funded by the NIH for 4 years. I worked in the study between 1992 and 1996. The Pima Indians were one of the pre-Columbian migrations into the Americas based on the physical anthropological evidence. It is believed that the Pima Indians left somewhere from Central Asia 35,000 years ago, crossed the Bering Land Bridge during winter time, and they would get trapped on the other side during summer when the land bridge, the ice bridge would melt. So they would get trapped and they would walk into the Americas looking for food. Many of them ended up going into South America, and a small group came back, came back and settled in the Gila River Valley in Arizona, which is near Phoenix. So it's estimated around 2,500 of them returned to Arizona. And what was interesting was several people had studied that reservation in the early part of 1900s, including Elliot Jocelyn. Until about 1920, 1927, diabetes was never noted as a big problem in the population. There were, three or four cases at the most in a population of 8,000 people or 7,000 people at the time. But suddenly, a survey in the early 1960s noted a huge explosion of type 2 diabetes in the population, a huge explosion, to the point that in the early 1960s, a paper was written by Dr. Peter Bennett, who was my mentor when I worked in the study, that 50% by age 45 or 50 of the Pima population had diabetes. And in 1964, this paper was published in The Lancet, and it was a huge shock to the entire world, a huge shock to the entire world. And pretty much the theory at that time was the Pimas are genetically predisposed to diabetes and some sudden change in the environment. And what was that sudden change? It was the building of the Roosevelt Dam. It had destroyed their agricultural civilization, had changed them, had made them more reliant on federal subsidies, on federal spam foods that were coming from as subsidies, on the foods that were being generated from a neighboring metropolis like Phoenix, etc. But the theory pretty much was that that there's such an explosion of type 2 diabetes, 50% affected by age 45 or 50, is a Pima phenomenon. And little did the world realize that what was happening in the Pimas was what was anticipating for the rest of the world. And I'm going to show you some data from India very soon that's going to shock you. Today, diabetes is a huge and global problem. Current estimates from the International Diabetes Federation indicates there are 387 million people with diabetes, and that's the population of the United States plus the population of United Kingdom plus more. And within the next 20 years, we project we will add at least 205 million people. And I underline the word at least, because every time we revise the projections every 2 years, we seem to have underestimated the future burden. And this increase is across every region of the world, including sub-Saharan Africa, where there's a projected doubling of the numbers of cases of diabetes. India looms very high in terms of its burden. It's number two after China, and it's and has very high rates. And it's also affecting rural parts of low and middle income countries. People are asking me, is it an urban disease? No, it no longer is. In 1985-90, 1.8% of rural parts of the world were affected with diabetes. Now you're talking of roughly 8.6%, particularly in rural parts that are undergoing rapid economic development. The best data that are available from it for India comes from the city of Chennai, where since 1971, thanks to wonderful investigators like Dr. Ramachandran and Mohan, there have been population-based surveys of diabetes. Last night somebody was asking, are we noticing more diabetes just because of greater screening and detection? No, that is not the truth. There is a true increase in the rate of diabetes across the country. Like in 1971, 2.3% of the population of Chennai had diabetes, and by 2004, it was 14.3%, and I'm going to show you more recent data in a couple of minutes. But this increase is no longer just Chennai, it is across all cities of India, it is across many rural parts of India, it is in Karachi in Pakistan, it is in Dhaka in Bangladesh, it is in Colombo in Sri Lanka, it is in Latin America, it is in Shanghai, China, it is everywhere. So it's a global phenomenon that we are facing at the moment. In the United States, we have roughly about 38 to 40 million people who are foreign-born like me and who've migrated to that country. And this is a very rich resource in a global networked community where you have people from so many different countries. But especially, my colleague, Rena Ozer-Frank, wanted to examine diabetes rates or diabetes prevalence across these people from different countries who had been born in those different countries but had migrated to the United States. And what she found was migrants from the Indian subcontinent, India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, etc., had the highest prevalence, which is the proportion of people in the population is prevalence, the highest prevalence of diabetes across all immigrant groups in the United States, followed by from migrants from Africa. So in the US, we have two types of African people. One are the newer migrants, and the other who have lived in the United States for 200, 300 years. So, and in a way, they are different phenotypically, and I will come to why it might be because they have experienced different nutritional experiences and different experiences of environment. But what is important is that migrants from India, Pakistan, etc., and also from the Indian subcontinent, just like the Indian population here, have high rates of diabetes. And what is even more striking, when you look at these prevalence rates according to body weight, normal weight, overweight, and obesity, what is striking, and look at that line, the red line, the normal weight, whatever normal is, the normal weight Indian migrant in the United States has as high or even a higher prevalence of diabetes than your obese European, which must tell you that just weight does not explain diabetes in the Indian population. It may be because whatever fat we put on is being put on in the wrong place. We are accumulating fat easily on our organs. Or the other theory that I have been postulating of late is that maybe we also have a problem in terms of secreting insulin because of a number of reasons. We'll go to that later on. So I told you a minute ago, or 2 minutes ago, that in 1964 it was discovered that 50% of the Pima Indians had diabetes by age 45. Very recently we compared diabetes in Chennai, India, with the Pima Indians in the United States. And as you can see there, the green line is the Pima Indians. The purple line is the Chennai. 60% of the population of Chennai also has diabetes by age 55. And I will bet you this is going to be this likely true in many Indian cities, particularly the ones that experience rapid economic development. So this is a huge public health problem. But 50% by age 50 or 55, 50 or 55 today is not 50 or 55 years, 40 years ago. I think a 55-year-old today is a highly productive person. And I often question the logic of forcing people to retire at age 58 or 60 to leave employment. The idea has gotten away. In the US, there's no retirement age in the federal government or in academia, and even Europe is shifting on that on the ground. So it's a question of keeping people productive to older ages, which means they have to avoid diseases like diabetes too. So let's look at the prevalence of diabetes by body mass index, which is a measure of obesity, in Chennai, India. Some surprising results here. Even in people with a BMI of less than 18.5, that is fairly thin, 20% of the population of Chennai has diabetes. And in fact, two-thirds of the population of men in Chennai have BMIs of less than 25, and about a third of women have BMIs of less than 25. But even in that group, you have fairly high rates of diabetes. So yes, on the one hand, obesity is driving a lot of the diabetes, but maybe there's also another problem related to historical undernutrition and underweight that is playing a role. And this is where these data, these wonderful data from the Delhi birth cohort, which thanks to some visionary people, the study was set up 30, 40 years ago, they followed children from birth in a part of Delhi all the way through adulthood. And the line in red are children who were born below the average weight, average birth weight, in terms of they were below the low birth weight. And the line in green were children who were born of decent birth weight. And as you said, and the line really tracks glucose levels. People who go on to develop diabetes or pre-diabetes, they're called IGT or IFG. What you're seeing there, a child born underweight is at higher risk of developing diabetes later in life than a child born of normal weight. Of course, a child who's born overweight or big babies are also at risk, as you all know. But importantly, in the Indian context, particularly where there is so much of undernutrition and stunting, 30% of the Indian population is underweight, and a very high proportion of Indian children are stunted at young ages. Very high proportion of women during pregnancy are stunted. This may be affecting a later trajectory. Yes, on the one hand, we have to pay attention to adult lifestyle, which is playing a huge role, but what about the children, the time they're born? So not only is undernutrition a problem for cognitive development, for intellectual achievement, for infectious diseases, etc., it may also be a huge problem. So childhood undernutrition and maternal nutrition are very important in Indian context. So what's basically happening here is a child who was born underweight end up becoming obese relative to themselves because they are suddenly exposed to a new environment of low physical activity and diets that are poor in terms of modern day health. A very similar, but a different kind of finding in the United States, where we are dealing with another problem of a lot of obesity in a different way. My colleague Solveig Cunningham tracked 7,000 children from kindergarten from ages 5 to 14. So what she found was very interesting. By age 5, 15% of kindergarten children in the United States, and these are nationally representative data, were already overweight, and 12.5% of children were obese by age 5. But what is striking is that when you examine which of these children become obese after the age of 5, so because there is a penchant to say, let's go and address health in school, which is very important, but school health programs don't seem to have such an impact on obesity, but why? It is because of this. The incidence, which means the rate at which new cases are happening, is actually declining with age, meaning that already by age 5, 15% are overweight and 12.5% are obese. And beyond that, the children who are overweight at age 5 are 4 times at risk of becoming obese by age 14 compared to children who are normal weight at age 5. So if you take the data from India and the data from the United States, there is a and unifying idea here that the environment, the dietary environment, the physical activity environment, during childhood, the first 5 years of life, and increasingly to believe that during a woman's pregnancy and during a woman's childbearing years are extraordinarily important. And in fact, this idea has been put forward by my colleague, David Pettit from the Pima Indian Studies, showing that when a mother is diabetic, or when a mother's glucose levels are high, or when a mother is obese relative to herself during pregnancy, that impacts the child's risk of obesity, the child's risk of diabetes, and if the child is a female, that cycle continues. So one way, yes, we have to arrest diabetes in adulthood by doing what we can now, but equally important, it is important to pay attention to the nutrition of women of childbearing age, also of men of childbearing age, and particularly of children during the first 5 years of life. And this is a place where India has not done as well as it can. I'm always impressed by the way in which India could immunize 40 million people for polio within a year and help eradicate polio. So when India sets its mind, it's capable of doing it. But we need to do the same thing when it comes to childhood undernutrition and in terms of maternal nutrition and maternal mortality. So that really is the idea here, that yes, something is happening during pregnancy environment and early childhood environment that alters, it's not the gene, but it alters our gene expression. It changes the way our genes behave. It might be undernourishment in terms of proteins, in terms of, we can go into the details, it might be many things. But the first 1,000 days, pretty much,